social impact on our country. In fact, the problems that we had initially started out with a lot of time back was just look at the social cost. In few thousand crores of social cost of just fluorosis, just one problem, and annually across the country. And this is just an estimate from the crude studies. It takes arsenic, it takes diarrhea, deaths from childhood, deaths from diarrhea. Upon I think you cannot even enumerate the social cost. So we're talking about a massive footprint on the health sector in general. And then relationships, you know, diarrheal deaths, it has such an intricate relationship with maternal health, with number of children facing so many other issues. So we are talking about issues which have strong interlinkages with health and with many other sectors. This is a slide which I put up earlier, so I will go into it. Just putting it again back at the end of the session, that it's all linked together. A variety of ways. It's not even unraveled, all these linkages. But let us keep it at the back of our mind. This is one presentation which we missed. You know, there's a person from UNICEF who was going to present about chronic diarrhea, especially in children, childhood chronic diarrhea, and different efforts which are going on across the world, and quite focused in India. In Gujarat, in Uttar Pradesh, there is a large experimental program going on to address childhood diarrhea through water and zinc supplementation, along with others. I think WHO guidelines have talked about zinc supplementation a lot, and zinc deficiency, not just zinc deficiency, but then curative zinc acting as in terms of a curative supplementary effort for reducing episodes of death. So we are seeing interlinkages already from different sectors. Zinc also figured out in our bone minerals thing. So even in the nutrients thing, we are seeing cross linkages across fluoride. And you have this entire linkage, you know, and if you start from anywhere here, if you start from chronic contamination, biological contamination of water fluid, go on to diarrhea, loss of nutrients, which can lead to morbidity and mortality. But then coming back again from loss of nutrients, especially in children, repeated episodes to anemia, I think this a cycle which pushes itself forward again and again, and you see the evidences. We had worked on salinity a lot for several years. Alga has been a part of that effort, and you know, we have been having, especially this region, you know, Western India, Saurashtra, Kutch, and all these areas, high TDS, high salinity, and we've been, there's an also an impression, a widespread perception of renal stones being linked to kidney stone being linked to salinity. There are contrasting views on that. But yeah, surely water intake is a link to renal stones, whether directly or indirectly. I put that dotted line because I'm not getting positive, sure replies from doctors on this. But definitely there is a link, not maybe from their salinity directly, but at least through poor water intake and variety of different diseases, which other dietary problems as well. Similarly, you know, recent things which are coming up, we're constantly talking about contamination in water. But then another issue, especially connected with reverse osmosis, is that it takes out minerals in water. And there's a very interesting WHO report on nutrients in drinking water. So 2005-06 report, which means 5-6 years, but it's not received much attention. One definite thing which that report talks about is about water hardness and cardiovascular health. And fascinatingly, it's not about water hardness causing problems for cardiovascular health, but then water hardness helpful in prevention of cardiovascular health. And the linkage is from magnesium only. Because of magnesium deficiency being quite common, and food sources having calcium at least would be present in food sources, but then magnesium deficiency is quite common. And water hardness, especially with calcium and magnesium, might be actually a good dietary source of magnesium in areas which have high water hardness. And especially when we are talking about highly malnutrition areas, these trace minerals, let us take 100 milligrams of calcium that we find in limestone aquifers of Junagadh. 100 milligrams per liter, 100 out of the 1200 TDS, 100 milligrams is magnesium or calcium salts. So 100 out of 100 milligrams of calcium, even if there is bioavailability of 50%, so you get at least 50 milligrams of calcium from water. It is significant for a malnutrition person. And magnesium, especially since already there is deficiency, it might be significant. How well, especially magnesium in water, might be well. So there is an angle to look about, especially on reverse osmosis, which removes not just the contaminants but also the nutrients. Something to think about. Something which Dr. Sumit presented at the last. Just trying to put many of these thoughts together in terms of let us start maybe with contaminated drinking water and also low water consumption, leading to you know, just as in diarrhea and also when what we see in fluoride and anemia linkages, fluoride water leading to iron deficiency anemia, leading to nutrient absorption problems, nutrition deficiencies, which again increases the risk for communicable diseases. Can there be some kind of a larger thinking for water quality related problems in which nutrient deficiencies also play a role? And maybe can there be common interventions? We cannot just talk about salinity alone or fluoride alone. These all come together. There is diarrhea in the same area in which there is fluorosis, and all these are interconnections. But when we put all these things together, I think to me, there are just two basic things, you know, which is coming out in the session, which is safe water and nutrition. In terms of preventive health and also health-based services, once there is one people are affected with the disease. And in terms of safe water, there are a variety of different options. There's so much, there's a whole world of options which whatever suits the specific context of the place. And in terms of nutrition, there's definitely supplements and fortification is the way in which things are going worldwide in a larger sense. But just basic local food preservation can help us to a large extent. As Sunita ji pointed out, in terms of, you know, so many leaves which go missing, as he said, wheat grass, you know, wheat leaves, wheat grass so much helpful for anemia, which is the chlorophyll and hemoglobin connection, which is replacement of magnesium and iron. And then talk about so many leaves, like chana leaves go waste, wheat leaves, all these leaves go waste, you know, not just trees specific like moringa or the seasonal plant like as well, but all the plant, all that we grow, agriculture, all the leaves that we get. We think about fodder, we think, but you know, these are also food that we can consume, nutritious food. So maybe there are common, and in terms of interventions, you know, in terms of actual interventions on the ground, community-based interventions, at the base scale, you know, Sumit was talking about a business center, but then on the social sector, from the government to the public health side, the public side, intervention side, you think about community-based water, health, and nutrition centers, constituted at least, but they need to be supported by a range of services. You talk about telemedicine, but then you know, you need to have a variety of higher skilled services which can sustain those water nutrition health centers, at least at the base level. These are just thoughts which I have, and then summarizing the session as a whole, going forward for a discussion. I think these are all things which we have talked about. I'll just leave this slide at the end and go towards in the end on a positive note in terms of thinking that it is possible. It is possible to phase out the diseases. Polio, at least on day to day, it's a waterborne viral disease. There's a mix of interventions which have possibly led to at least a temporary withdrawal of polio. You can come across the border anytime because neighboring countries have it. But then, yeah, but even things like Lathyrism and things, we don't hear about it. But these were problems. In goiter, we don't hear about it. There are mixed views on IDM, but then still we don't. So maybe let us not hear about fluorosis also after some time. Maybe it's a generational change, not just people like us, but there are so many other factors which are coming first. You know, nutrition might improve over time. Maybe things could phase out. Let's hope that all these efforts together phase out these diseases completely. I thank all of you for this session and just open the floor for discussions. And would like to call upon a discussant, Alka Ravan, and the tentative point that we came across to look at mainstreaming these thoughts. You know, just if you take the context of this conference, sometimes health looks somewhat out of the session conference focus, but then water health is central to along with water. How can we mainstream these thoughts into larger interventions in watershed, agriculture, public health? How can we think about doing this? Alka.
Thanks, Sundar. I just felt, you know, that I'm not done matriculation and I was sitting in a graduation.